I think this session is critical on closing the skill gap. You've all heard about that, yes, there is a gap somewhere. You don't know what it is and what skill sets are there and the need of soft skills. And I think Binod's session is right bang on time in talking about how do you close that skill gap and if at all you have a skill gap. Binod, just to give you a background, I've known him for over a decade. And thanks to CFA, he attended one of our first conferences in Bombay back in 2011, the India Investment Conference, for which next year I think we are going to celebrate 10 years. So that's how I know Binod. He has a very interesting profile in a mix of things. I think a lot of you will be able to resonate with his profile and his journey. I'll not take the thunder out of his profile, and I'll let Binod introduce himself. Binod, over to you.
Thanks. Hi, everyone. You know, when they first invited me, I looked at my timing. I said 2:45 to 3:45. That's the worst possible time for a speaker to speak, right? I mean, seriously, everyone is full of lunch, wants to go home. So I'm really delighted to see such a big crowd here. Thank you so much for staying back. Special thanks to Sandeep, Somik, BD, CFA Society India for inviting me. And I want to start with a story. Hence the blank slide. Okay. The story is about this guy, and I want you to follow the story very carefully, right? So I know him very personally, this person. He's a family friend. Did a pre-degree? Have you heard of pre-degree in India? Pre-degree? Just before degree, you do your 2 years, plus two. It's called plus two, yeah. Did his plus two very poorly in mathematics, tried to get into engineering, could not get into engineering, because in engineering, you need to have high scores in maths, right? And then what do you do when you don't get into engineering or medicine? BCom. You go for BCom, right? BCom, 3 years in some tier two city, in some average college, you know, some very, 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 very average college. Didn't go to college, this guy. Okay. Skipped classes, was watching cricket matches sitting at home. I know him personally, so you know. Came out of the BCom with a second class degree. Okay. Second class degree, BCom, living in a tier two city from a tier three university. What is the hope for this guy? You tell me, is there any hope? I mean, yeah, marriage, probably. Good idea, marriage. Okay, guys, don't listen to him, okay? Marriage has other issues, okay, which we'll talk about later. So that made me think about this guy's situation, right? So we're talking about what? And he was very shy. Painfully shy, painfully timid, right? No friends. If you can call his cousin his friend. Cousins are by default your friends anyway. It's not that you're going to acquire a friend. You know, a few friends, very shy, didn't used to meet people, very short-tempered, had no idea about how the real world worked, very naive, right? Knew his maybe commerce and economics and finance a bit. So the reason I'm mentioning his story, which is very interesting, I'll come back to him later, is because when I spoke to Somik and Sandeep and they said, what's the topic? So Sandeep said, you have to talk about, what's the topic, sorry, this one, right? Closing the skills gap. And BD also said, you have to talk about closing the skills gap. And when director members of CFA Society India tell you to talk about something, you talk about it. You don't have a choice. Then I thought about, you know what, this guy, my family friend, his issue was not about really skills, was it? I mean, yes, he had some skills, but what skills? He had some other issues. He could not get himself a job, right? I mean, he used to actually go around and apply for positions of assistant accountant, right? It's a clerical job, right? Data entry job. And he would not even get a call for interview. You talk about South India, some tier two city. So I changed this title a little bit, with apologies to Sandeep and everyone else. I said, let's call it a employability gap. It's not really a skills gap that he had, that a lot of people have. It's a work readiness gap. It's the lack of ability to get a job, the right job that you want. Do you agree with that? Yes? It's a work readiness gap. So let's talk about that. But before that, I'll talk about myself, because I like talking about myself. I told BD not to introduce me for that reason. And he was very nice to, you know, comply with that. Yeah. So my background, probably a lot of you know me, 2 decades in the Middle East with KPMG, Anderson, EY, and audit. I co-founded a training company after 17 years in corporate life called Genesis. I sold the company 2 years ago to Kaplan. I'm sure most of you have heard of Kaplan. Schweizer? Yes, Schweizer. So that sort of strikes your mind. Right? So Schweizer bought my company 2 years ago. I exited completely. And it was a very successful exit in terms of getting the right partner. And the journey was fantastic. I ended up teaching thousands of CFA students, right? And as of now, we have about 250 charter holders who've passed through us. So it's been a very rewarding journey. Additionally, you know, I'm also a mentor. There's a platform called Reach in the UAE. I'm based in the UAE in Dubai, where we mentor young women professionals. And I sort of do work on that platform. I'm also a columnist with Gulf News and some other national newspapers back in the Middle East. I'm a TV guest, although I appear mostly in CNBC Arabia, talking about US and European markets, stocks and bonds. I don't get into currencies or commodities. Okay, that's not my area of expertise. I'm a platform speaker. I speak a lot of quite a few events in the Middle East. Not so many events in India, but maybe this is the new beginning of Indian events. I'm also a podcaster. I'm going to get into podcasting soon. I'll talk about that. And I'm also a UK qualified executive coach. So I thought, you know what, people said, you're good at teaching. Why don't you take that to a next level and talk about mentoring and coaching? So I said, okay, what's the qualification for mentoring and coaching? So this ILM level 7 qualification, which is apparently one of the top 3 qualifications globally on coaching and mentoring. And of course, very importantly for you, I'm a chartered accountant, okay? That's very important that you know that, right? To establish the credibility and that I've been through the same journey that you have, studying income tax and everything else, right? And I'm also a CFA charter holder, right? Just to make sure that, you know, we covered all the bases, right? I would have normally stopped here, but then BD said you've got to talk about yourself, other stuff that you do, okay? So I said, okay, I'll talk about other stuff that you do because he said the audience might find it interesting and enlightening. So apart from all this, I'm also a mountaineer, okay? So what I do in my spare time, when I can get spare time, is to escape into the mountains. So this is the highest mountain I've been to so far, is Mount Mera Peak in Nepal, 6,500 odd meters, 22,000 feet. And the year before that was in, that's all my pictures, by the way, not photoshopped, huh? This is all me, okay? It's not graphical manipulation. So I do a lot of this stuff. It's hard, it's risky, it's challenging. It keeps me on my toes. So a lot of journey. So I've done some hikes and high altitude mountains in India as well. So this is me on, have you heard of Stock Kangri in Ladakh? So Stock Kangri Ladakh is one of the highest peaks in India. So the picture on the left is when I made it to the top. The picture on the right is me suffering to the top, right? You can see the expression on my face, right? It's almost half dead. Okay. The camera caught it perfectly. Yeah. This is at about 6,000 meters above sea level. Around me are the Himalayas. You can see all the way into Pakistan, actually. Perfectly clear day if you stand on top of the mountain. Very hard day of hiking, extremely hard. 18 hours of hiking, little food and water. I got snow blind after that. Hard lesson learned. And then, of course, quite a few serious hikes. On the extreme top right-hand corner, is me and the mountain in the very back. Do you know what that is? Can you identify it on the top right-hand corner? That's Everest, yeah. That's Everest. I'm not on Everest, obviously. That is Everest. So this is in Everest Base Camp in Nepal, 2013 December. It was a winter trek. No one goes in winter to trek. I said, let me do a challenge to myself and go in winter to trek, right? It was freezing cold at night, -5 degrees. So all these are all those pictures, right? I also do a lot of high-altitude cycling. So apart from mountaineering, I also do a lot of mountain biking. So these are the pictures from a fantastic journey I had 6 years ago, where we cycled from Manali to Leh. You're aware of Manali and Leh, right? But cycling from Manali to Leh is a different adventure. Not the Enfield Bullet, Royal Enfield Bullet going, cycling. So we went through about 5 mountain passes, took about 10 days, 560 kilometers. If you ask me which is the most memorable adventure of my life, this was it. 22 people and me, 22 strangers and me, camping every night in the middle of nowhere. I mean, literally in the middle of nowhere, in Ladakh, right? In the Spiti Valley, eating together. I made good friends, and I'm still in touch with them even now. So fantastic adventures. The extreme bottom right-hand side picture is me at the top of Kardungla, which is about 5,600 meters above sea level. That was after 8 hours of cycling through snow and rain and sleet. I almost gave up, but I had a guy cycling with me, so, you know, like a mentor, you know, who really helped me keep myself focused for the 8 hours. This is actually pictures of my trip from Pune to Goa. 5 days back to back, 550 kilometers, great group, ending on Goa beach with grilled fish, nothing like that. I don't drink, so I couldn't drink anything else. So a lot of adventures, right? So the reason I'm showing this to you is because when you go through all these adventures, whether it's mountaineering or cycling, you learn a lot about yourself, right? And I want to convey that message. You learn a lot about yourself, about that things are possible. Things are tough, but very possible. And you've got to take small steps. So I have failed on mountains. I have had to come back from summits. I have failed on cycle trips. But you don't take the failure too hard. And you always recognize the fact that a mountain, just like a career, a job market, can turn against you. And anytime you go to a mountain, like I'm going to an expedition in a few weeks' time, the chance of making it to the top are 50-50. I know this. Okay, how much have I trained for this last 6 months? Okay, so imagine going for 6 months of training, like 6 months of training for CFA or, you know, preparing yourself for a career, and then going to the point and saying, you know what, the CFA exam has been canceled. Exactly how you feel when you go to a mountain. You don't know whether you'll make it. You don't know whether you'll survive. If you make it, fantastic. You've got to be patient. Yeah. So that's pretty much, you know, the spiel about what I do outside of the CFA and everything else. So I want you to do a small exercise among yourself, right, among everyone sitting here. I want you to turn to your neighbor and you tell him three interesting things about yourself. 1 minute. Clear? Okay. And I want your neighbor to turn to you and he tells you three interesting things about himself. So both of you will tell three interesting things about yourself. You have 2 minutes, starting now. I'm watching you guys. You better start interacting, right? Okay, one minute more. Abhishek, I'll pick on you. You better find him. Okay, time out. Time out, guys. Enough. Time out. Wow, a lot of interesting discussions going on, huh? Don't get too personal. Just, you know, just keep it professional, right? Right. So I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why I asked for this small exercise. But before I go further, you know the guy I talked about, the BCom guy. You remember him? Shy. Tell me what you remember about him quickly. Short-tempered. Shy. Naive. Hopeless, a failed engineering. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention to you, he wrote IIM CAT twice and didn't make it. After BCom, okay, you know, very, very underprepared. So all this, right? No engineering, couldn't get into the CAT, second class degree, naive, unskilled. That guy was me. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, you know, you have a background and you've seen my background here as well. So a very important point of action here is that a great future is not determined by what happened in the past. Okay, you don't need a great past to have a great future. You don't need to have a great past to have a great future. Please remember this. It's a very, very important point, yeah? I've seen, talk to people who have lost confidence, who think they're inferior, tier 2, 3, or 4, tier 6, whatever it is. You've seen my CV. It's not made up. It's completely true. Okay, I have no shame in admitting it because I want you guys to change. Okay, now moving on to the next thing, right? So this was a discussion I had. I hope you can read it, right? This was a discussion I had last month in Bangalore with the talent acquisition head of a major multinational bank. I've highlighted the red bits, right, which is important for you. See the bits he's talking about? You can read. Finance chaps lack, what are you saying? Agility, yes? They'll tell you why something can't be done. Yeah, we know all people like that. It can't be done. No. Okay. They will give you, they can't deal with multiple bosses. They can't work in a multicultural setup. Very importantly, they're also very bookish. What does bookish mean? I mean, they know about financial reporting and derivatives and economics, but outside that, nada, nothing. Okay. And finally, they are not adaptable or comfortable presenting to a large audience. This statement was made to me by the acquisition head, and this guy, by the way, when I say talent acquisition, he looks after 35,000 employees in India, okay, recently, and this is his point. So I would suggest you look at it very carefully and listen to what he's saying, right? Each word is important, okay? Now, I'm going to base the rest of my presentation on this and talk about how we can address this, yeah? So we have a skills gap, obviously. We obviously have a skills gap. On top, you have employers, and on the bottom, you have employees, or well, potential employees, yeah, who want to be employees, yes? And you have this big chasm, big crevasse, or whatever you call it in the middle. And the question is there a gap? Yes, there is a gap. How big is the gap? Pretty big. So I'm going to talk about what is the gap about? Why does the gap exist even, you know? Let's talk about that as well. And very importantly, because that's the title, right? How do we close the gap? How do we close the gap? Yeah, because the gap can be closed. I gave you my story, right? Do you think I'm shy and short-tempered? Well, short-tempered, you don't know. Let's see for the questions, right, that BD will ask me in the 15 minutes later. Yeah? So CFA instituted a survey recently saying, how will future professionals land a job in investment management? I'm going to pick that from CFA Institute and talk about that in more detail. What they said, number one, okay, people need to have analytical ability. Now, they are quite specific in the definition of analytical ability. What they mean is basically what? Solid economic reasoning and ability to see the big picture. You must be up to date. And we'll talk about that as well, yeah, later. You need both maths and economic skills. You must be able to tear about financials. I love tearing about financials. If you're a chartered accountant, you should love tearing about financials. Okay? That should be a bread, butter, and jam. Okay? That gives you a very big edge, by the way. You need a lot of attention to detail. Okay. So going back to the earlier one, now let me give you an example of this. What is the biggest current issue facing the globe today in terms of economics? Give me one of the top three. Trade wars, thank you, trade wars, brilliant. Everyone knows this, right? Morning, evening, afternoon, all you hear is trade wars. What is Brexit, exactly, yes, Brexit. Sorry? Interest rates, exactly, absolutely. Economic slowdown. Let's take trade wars. What is the impact of trade wars? Give me one impact. Economic slowdown. High transaction cost. Sorry? Increase import duties. So basically, if you look at Brexit as an example of demonstrating analytical ability, it's basically what? Impact on import duties. Cost of importing goes up. Companies that are exposed get affected. So I cover the US markets a lot, right? In the US, sectors that are affected are what? Automobiles. Because they can't export to China anymore, difficult. Retail, because importing cost has gone up.
et cetera, et cetera. What other aspect of the world economics gets affected by trade wars? Interest rates, isn't it? Currency, but let's talk about interest rates. Why is it that Jerome Powell is cutting rates these days? He's cutting rates because there's an economic slowdown that might seep into the US. Now, we can go on and on talking about trade wars. I'm just one small example of your analytical ability to see the big picture and yet see the details. One story I'll never forget is, have you heard of Liar's Poker, the book written by Michael Lewis? I think everyone had read that, right? There's one story there of this guy, what is his name, Michael Lewis, sitting next to a bond trader in the London office of Salomon Brothers, right, in 1986. At that point, there was a Chernobyl nuclear disaster, if you remember. There was a nuclear reactor in Chernobyl in Ukraine, in erstwhile USSR, which exploded or released toxic, yeah? Now, normally when a normal human being, like you and me, get that news, what's the first thing you think? Don't act too smart. First thing, what do you think? I mean, oh God, right? How many people died, nuclear waste, clean up, right? Now the guy sitting next to him, next to Michael Lewis, the first thing he did was to go and order 3 ships full of potatoes online. As in, he's a trader. He's a commodities trader, not bond trader. You know why? Sorry? Because Ukraine happens to be the breadbasket of USSR, and most of the potatoes grown in the USSR are grown in Ukraine, and by buying 3 shiploads of potatoes, he's immediately got a huge arbitrage profit. Now, I'm not saying you should do that and look for disasters and go around buying potatoes, but it gives an example of what? Analytical, big picture, small details, right? I'll never forget that story. Broad knowledge. I was talking earlier about the fox and the hedgehog, right? The fox knows many things. The hedgehog knows only one thing. Increasingly, we're living in a world where you need to know many things. You need to be a fox, pretty much, yeah? So what does that mean? CA, CFA, FRM, SKYA, and all the Cs, right, CPA, they teach you what? A specific knowledge base, right, body of knowledge. You learn about portfolio management or wealth management or, right, taxes in CA. But you don't learn much about critical thinking, do you? Do you? I mean, tell me. Do you learn about critical thinking in CA? I did my CA, right? A lot of my time was memorizing the tax laws and the company laws, right? Section 142A, 44AB, blah, blah, blah. Yes? CFA has a lot of memorization as well, right? It does not increase that much critical thinking, right? So what we're saying is what? You need to have a lot of knowledge about history, political economics, philosophy, science, et cetera, et cetera. I'll tell you why. If you know this, you become much better at asset management and equity research. I'll give an example. Okay. Do you think that the euro currency will collapse? Yes, okay, interesting. Anybody else? The eurozone will collapse? Yes, okay. I think not. Because if you look at history, the reason why the European community was set up was a political agenda, not an economic agenda. It was to prevent the recurrence of the 2 disastrous world wars that almost destroyed the world. So Europe, for its own sake and for the sake of the world, are very conscious of the fact that they cannot disintegrate, despite Brexit and Italy and Greece and Portugal. So if you're an analyst, you should know this, that whatever happens, which is why Mario Draghi said what? I will do whatever it takes. It is not a simple statement. He was echoing what his constituents wanted, right? Number 2, why is the trade war happening between the US and China? Because China wants to regain its or reclaim its past glory from 700 years ago. And why does the US want to reduce China's scope? Because the US wants to remain at the top. Also, if you have looked at a lot of events and what Trump is saying, US feels that it's been ripped off in the whole deal, in the bargain. That people like China and even India have taken advantage of the US in trade deals and intellectual property, et cetera, for the last 40, 50 years. That's history for you, right? You need to know your history there, for example. Yeah? There's other bit of history. Why did Trump come to power? Why did Brexit happen? Why do you have what you call neo-nationalists in Germany and Austria? Because of globalization over the last 40 years, isn't it? What happens with globalization? People lose jobs. Inequality increases. You have strong men. So nationalist politics is going to happen, it's going to increase, it's going to get worse and worse. That's all based on history. You need to know that, for example, right? Ability to reason. One of the biggest issues I face, by the way, when I am looking at news, because I prepare for, you know, the classes, I prepare for my broadcast, is There's so much noise. Right? You know what noise means? Noise means what? Rubbish. That's it, rubbish, right? And there's only what? About 5% of signal. If you're an engineer in the room, you can know the difference between noise and signal, right? I want to hear signal, not the noise. I find it interesting. I don't mean it as a measure of disrespect, but whenever I come to India and I live in a hotel, I open or switch on the TV, I get bombarded with news. Okay? I look at Economic Times, all I'm looking at is what? Scandal, investigation, okay, some other scandal, some counter-allegation made on an earlier allegation, right? And in some page 15 or page 20, you'll find some insight. Is that right or not? So we're living in a world where what? Sound bites are more important than sense, to be honest. And it becomes extremely important to analyze the data. So for example, I'll give you an example of that, right? AI. So let's talk about AI. I was attending a conference recently, listening to a speaker. He said, AI, ML, yes, is picking up. A lot of advances have been made, right? In voice recognition, in natural language processing, in image processing, et cetera, et cetera. But it's not going to take over the world immediately. Because if you look at the last 30 years, it has been a steadily growing process of sophistication. Lower-level jobs will get automated. People become unemployed. But high-level wealth managers, high-level asset managers, like BD, for example, will remain employed. Hopefully, BD. Yes, because you have a skill which cannot be replicated by a machine. I hope. Right? So in interviews, as you know, they want to know, for example, if you go to interview JP Morgan or Goldman, they want to know what have you done? Why did you make the decisions you made? Career decisions, investing decisions, for example. What is your process of thinking? I don't really care about the answer. So my question to you about trade wars and euro currency was not to know whether, you know, I was trying to think, understand your logic, the process. I want to hear the process. Investors want to hear the process. That's how you convince them, right? With process, not with empty arguments. That's something else, again, that people lack, to be honest, because a lot of people don't read. Is that true? So if anyone follow me on LinkedIn, I read voraciously. I read about 25, 30 books every year. I wish I could read more. So right now, in the flight I was reading, I'm going back also, I'll read. I don't look at the TV on the screen. If I have a minute in the cab, I'll read. My laptop bag always has a book in it. Okay, I'm still old-fashioned, by the way. I'm not using Kindle, bit old that way. I think that is very important. And we talk about one way of closing the skills gap is by reading about history and other stuff that's happening around you. Out-of-the-box thinking. Again, you have been so constrained by the curriculum, right? The body of knowledge, the CFA, the CA, the CPA, the SCIA, whatever, that you cannot think outside that framework. Is that true, right? Yes, time value of money, present value, future values, yes. For us, that is the holy grail. I'm not saying that is wrong. But try to explore other things, right? Look at other areas. For example, one common solution to the world's economic problems is guaranteed minimum income. It's been discussed, debated, but not been implemented in most countries. Now, maybe that's a solution to what a lot of inequality we have right now, for example. It can solve a lot of political problems as well. I'm just giving an example of how we can get into out-of-box thinking. Yeah. My friend, once I met him, like this guy, the asset manager that I was talking about earlier, I met him at a coffee. We had a coffee together in Dubai last month. And I said, someone comes to you and asks for a job, entry-level job. And he's an asset manager, right? So what's the entry-level job? Analysis, right? Analyst, equity researcher. He said, what do they say? I asked him, what do they say and what do you say? He said, they all tell me they have a passion for finance. Right? Everyone has passion, right? Everyone has passion for finance. What do you like? Finance? Why do you like finance? I have a passion for finance. Okay. What does that mean? Passion? But you also have a passion for cricket and passion for Bollywood and passion for other things I can't talk about in the public platform here, obviously. Does passion mean anything really? So it doesn't mean much, to be honest. Unless passion is defined and focused, it doesn't mean much. And one of the worst words I use is passion. I hate the word, actually, passion. It's been overused and overhyped so much. It's become detestable, right? It's a cliche now. Passion, have passion. How do you get passion? You can't go and buy passion, yeah? Where do you, you can't do that. So he said, his main question when people say they have a passion is what? Do you have an interest in financial markets? What have you, and if you have an interest, what have you done? Have you invested in markets? Have you lost money, ideally, right? That's how you learn, right? So one guy who met him, who he did not hire him, but he was right at the top, really impressed him because this candidate who met my friend, who is an asset manager, said, I spend the bulk of my day going through financial statements and tearing them apart. He just loved it. It's not because someone told him to, or part of exam preparation, he just loved it. Now imagine if you go and tell an interviewer that this is what I do, and you can actually talk at an expert level on sector and company, how much of an impact you make, right? Think about that, right? Yeah. And Gary Cohn, I don't know whether you know this name, Gary Cohn used to be the president of Goldman Sachs. He had a very infamous tenure as Trump's national economic advisor, was it? Yeah. And had a falling out as well. But look at what he said, right? Upon graduation, I had no job, I had no interviews, no prospects, but he had enormous passion, and his passion defined or channeled in the form of what? Financial markets, which is how, one reason why he sort of went up the high. And Goldman Sachs is very difficult to go up in, as you can imagine, right? It's like a very difficult hierarchy. It's a very meritocratic company, right? Sunil Singhania, who's not here today, I remember his interview with the CFA Institute, where he said he used to be a stockbroker initially. That's how he got into investing. He loved investing, he loved markets, and that's how he got into heading Reliance Mutual Fund, one of the largest mutual funds in India, not Southeast Asia. So that's about the passion bit, right? Extremely important. Anything else? Have I missed out anything? So we talked about analytical ability and broad knowledge and what else? Do you remember anything else I said? Sorry? Out of the box thinking, right? Then? Yeah. What else is there? I mean, is this all you need to succeed in finance, in asset management? Let's be specific, right? Asset management. Abhishek, come on, man, tell me. I'll pick on you, man. I'm just writing in front of me. Right in front of me, right? Sorry? Risk-taking ability, interesting. Any other? Manan, any other ideas? Come on. I can't hear you. Sense of humor. Okay, that's good. So what I find lacking, number one, I mean, there are quite a few skills lacking. What I find lacking is communication skills. Okay, and these are examples of messages sent to me. Okay, I won't name who. I can't name who, obviously. That's not proper, right? Messages sent to me via LinkedIn in the last 1 month, 2 months. And I'm just showing it to you to show the level of English language skills, and there's a reason why. Okay, I'm not showing it here to ridicule anyone, obviously. Yeah. Can you help me to project myself for further video projections? I don't know what he meant. I don't know whether he knew what he meant, or that he knew that I didn't know what he meant. You know, so it is complete chaos. Okay, that is one sample. I lost myself in a confusion. So again, I don't know what he meant. I think I knew what he meant, but still, you know. Quite vague, if you think about it. And I need an advice. Currently, I am working in commodities markets as fundamental analyst, but now I want to shift to equity research side. I didn't get a clue how I can jump the equity sector. So now we laugh about it. This is a serious issue. This is a serious issue. My only edge when I was a BCom guy, right? My edge then and now, well, my only edge then was I was very good at speaking. I had excellent command of the language. That's what propelled me through my career to a lot of extent. Of course, CA and CFA. Don't look at me that way, guys. I have some substance. Huh? It's not just style and talking. I know stuff. But a lot of people, especially in tier 2, 3 cities, who have not studied English as a native language, like most of us, who have not gone to English school, went to Malayalam medium or Tamil medium or Hindi medium, have a massive issue with the language. Have a massive issue with the language. So you have a big issue with English language. And unfortunately, exams are in English, interviews are in English, communication within companies is in English, reports are in English. You know, what do you do? Okay, that becomes a big issue for a lot of people. We'll talk about how to solve it later. Yeah, am I right or not? I mean, So Dilbert, of course, everyone's favorite corporate cartoonist, right? Or corporate satirist, yeah? Your communication skills are so poor that I gave up trying to understand what you wanted and instead put some random numbers on a spreadsheet. Why didn't you just listen, ask me to clarify? Apparently your listening skills need working too. So Dilbert, of course, makes these ridiculous cartoons, but has a kernel of truth in it, obviously. Right? Everything he says. Yeah. So CFA Institute, apart from saying, talking about analytical ability and, you know, broad knowledge, they also talked about ability to communicate. The report has this also, ability to communicate. Extremely important, right? Because it's a people business, you're not talking to machines, you're talking to people. People talking to people. People hire people, right? People don't hire CVs. I hire Manan or Abhishek or Harsh or someone. Right? How do people? You need to, I mean, as asset manager, you need to talk to investors to explain bad performance, right? You can't just say, you know, minus 25% this year, that's it. Just leave it there. Next year, chalega, we'll try and make it. No, you can't. People want explanations. How do you convince them? With colleagues, how do you communicate? How do you convince your colleagues here? How do you convince your team members to work with you? Yeah. You can stick to what you believe, but you know, can you change your mind when you have a stronger argument? So communication skills is actually widely misunderstood. It's a lot of things, by the way. It's not just speaking. Speaking is only one aspect of it, right? There's also what? What's the rise of the top? Listening. A lot of us listen to, what do we do? Do we listen properly? No, we listen to what? What you want to hear, and listen to respond, right? So BD is talking to me, I'm not listening to what he says, not real truth, right? But I'm thinking of how can I give him a smart-ass reply, so he thinks well of me. So it's all about, you know, going back and forth. I don't really listen to him. Influencing, negotiating, facilitating channels, cultural awareness. This is what communication skills is really about. It is not just about talking and writing proper English. And if you don't have the skills in today's world, you're lost. Right? You have to influence people. You have to communicate with people. The reason why I'm a mentor, that I'm on CNBC, that I was very good at teaching is because of one major reason is communication skills. One major reason. It can take you a lot of places. It can take you a lot of places. Trust me, personal experience. Yeah? And it's very empowering. There's nothing more empowering than knowing that you can stand in front of an audience or in a meeting room and convince them. Is there? Tell me about it. Is there anything more liberating or more confidence boosting or empowering? Not to me. It sort of sets you apart, right? It raises your game. It makes you feel that you can contribute something. Yeah. Second issue, or second soft skill that people don't have is collaboration. I had the same issue, by the way. Collaboration basically means main things, yeah? Brainstorming, working in teams, delegate appropriately, all these things, right? Yeah. Now, I'll tell you, personal story, right? I was never good in delegating appropriately. How many of you are good delegators? Raise your hands. And don't lie to me. One person out of two, well, three, some people are like, I'm not sure. Okay. Five, six out of 240. Why don't you delegate? Because you don't trust. Exactly. That guy will screw up. I don't want to clean up his mess. Let me do it myself, save myself time and do it. I used to do that all the time. Right? And guess what happened? What will happen if you don't delegate? You get burnt out, seriously burnt out. 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. A, number one. Number two, you're not using your best skills. Number three, you're not developing your team. Number four, it's bad for the company as a whole. Right? The other issue I had was accepting constructive criticism. How many of us can actually take criticism and smile back and actually implement what the guy said? I used to have huge issues, by the way. It used to be a personal thing, right? Who, you telling me? I am a chartered accountant. I am a CFA charter holder. First attempt, very important. First attempt pass, very, very important. Okay? And you, not CFA pass, right? Some pass. You're telling me how to do this work, how to deal with people. Who are you? It was a big change. We joke about it, but this was one of the biggest transformations I had to undergo after running my own company. Managing people, accepting the fact that you're not good at everything and you can't ever be good at everything. And a lot of you have that issue. I had that issue. I still have that issue. Although now I get criticism, I think about it, I don't react. And then after thinking about it, I say, you know what? He was right. So now I draft emails, but I don't send the email out. I keep it in the outbox. Yeah. Analyze without blaming. Yeah. We Desis are very good at many things. We're good at very many things, by the way. But one thing we are expert at is what? Blaming. Anything goes wrong, the question is not how to fix it. The first thing to do, first item on the agenda is what? Before we clean up the mess is what? Who is the bakra? Who did this? And let's chop him. Let's hang him out. Let's humiliate him. Right? Make sure he doesn't go anywhere in future. Make sure his career is a big black cross. Right? Same thing here as well. And finally, we all like to take credit when someone else has done the work. Someone else is talking about, somebody else, you know, during, before the presentation, about a guy who took credit for work done by others in an open meeting. Happens all the time. Okay? So collaboration, another soft skill that we need to develop, really, quite important. Personal effectiveness, which, if you really break it down, as per CFA Institute, means what? Self-confidence. A lot of people have issues with self-esteem, for reasons we talked about, English language skills, et cetera, right? Stress management, resilience. We can't take the stress. We just can't take the stress. It's just too much, right? We can't manage it. Yeah. Time management is a problem. So when I was working in audit, by the way, this is about 15, 17 years ago, when I was working in audit once upon a time, I could never manage my time properly. My projects never finished on time. It was always over budget, over time. Always time overruns, always cost overruns. And if you work in audit, one thing you learn is what? How to manage your time and your budget. I learned that the hard way, yeah? Hard way. Persistence, extremely important, as long as, and of course, self-motivation, right? The last is very important, by the way. I was talking to a few students just before the presentation, and everyone expects others to help them, right, in some way. You're not going to get anywhere if you're riding on someone else's shoulder, to be honest. I mean, no one here is a self-made man or self-made woman. All of us had help, right? I mean, all of us, from mentors, colleagues, parents, relatives. Who are we to say that, you know, we are self-made? We're not. That's a false claim, right? So self-motivation is extremely important. Now, the question is, how do you get motivated is a different issue altogether, right? But we need to be self-driven. So one of the best things that my boss ever said to me, he said quite a few best things. Okay? One of the best things he ever said was, you're always self-regulated, Binod. You know what that means, right? It means what? You can manage on your own. You don't need to be supervised. In fact, I hated to be supervised, to be honest. I could do my own stuff. I was very good at doing my own stuff. I would do a very good job as well. But telling me to do stuff, I would get pissed off. Yeah? And humility. I was telling somebody else the other day that if you look at the world of finance, you'll find the maximum amount of jerks working in finance. Yes or no? People in finance, of course, won't admit it. People working outside finance probably like, finance, for some reason, has the largest number of jerks. Disproportionate number of jerks, okay? And the reason why you have that is because finance is the only area, think about it, the only area, medicine, engineering, is the only area we cannot distinguish between luck and skill. Am I right or not? Right? Seriously, so if there's any, you know, I keep picking on BD as an example, but he's within, you know, he's a close friend, he can take it, I hope. But if BD has a fantastic result for 1 year and delivers great results to his clients, right? How much of that result is based on luck? The market went up, he just happened to invest in the right sectors and companies, and it went up. Or how much is based on skill? To this day, we still have not got a methodology, am I right, to differentiate between luck and skill. So what happens? People made fantastic returns, they think they are gods. I made it happen. Not you, the market went up. Any fool, any chimpanzee would have made money. You also made money. So I made some money this year by buying and selling tech stocks, right? Any person with a half literate person could have made money in tech stocks over the last 2 years, right? So I'm not patting myself on the back at all. I'm extremely realistic about the fact that I made some money, but that money was because tech stocks were in growth phase. Now if I put money in, I'll probably lose it. So humility, extremely important, right? And humility is very important because why? Market volatility. And now we are stuck with market volatility. We know this, right? Trade wars, interest rate cuts, blah, 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 Brexit. You're going to be seeing a lot of range-bound trading going on for the next year, probably a couple of years. So going back to the earlier part, what did you learn? That the three things about yourself. What was, anyone tell me? Abhishek, I told you I'll pick on you, so I'm keeping my promise of picking on you. So what do you learn about who was sitting next to you? Abhishek is blaming the other person is blaming Abhishek. There's a blame game going on right now. Yes. Is there a mic somewhere, please? Can someone give a mic? Yes. You're learning Vedic astrology. Oh, wow, okay, interesting. Sorry? Not using astrology. You're managing money using astrology.
Not
Okay, just kidding, just kidding. That'll be nice. The stars don't look nice today. Don't invest in Reliance today. So that's one thing. Anything else? He's reading Bhagavad Gita. Okay, interesting. Okay.
And third, he does 160 kg deadlift.
Sorry, what's that?
160 kg deadlifts.
160 kg deadlifts. Oh my God. Okay. I should learn something from you, man. I'm trying to lift weights myself. And anybody else want to share about what they learned about their part? Sandeep, I had to pick on you, man. There's no, you can't hide from me. Tell me. He'll have to be a singer. Okay. Go on. And vice versa. We learned something about our friend Sandeep here.
Finally, we got you as a speaker.
Nothing.
Sandeep has like pretty much done everything in the corporate world across domains.
Okay. Well, he claimed that, right? I mean, you don't know. That's what he claims. Right. So the reason why I talked about this exercise, because going back to what Eric Sims said in the morning, what Eric Sims said, did you ever remember what he said? You got to stand out, right? Or use the terms, you have to have a signature dish. If you're a chef, you need to have a signature dish that makes you stand out, that makes you differentiate yourself, right? And this statement from the CIO of a major asset manager in the UAE, again, I've highlighted the red bits, the important bits on red, right? You can't come and connect with somebody and instantly hope to make a relationship. You can't, right? People come to me, people come to him and ask for a job immediately. First thing after LinkedIn, right? So these days I'm very, very scared of connecting with people on LinkedIn. Because the moment you click accept, within 5 minutes you'll get an email saying, sir, my CV attached, please find a job. I'm exaggerating, of course, yeah, bit. But look at the second paragraph, right? This is what he was telling me about issues he faced with candidate. Tell me something I know I'll remember about you, right? And even if I don't have a job for you now, I might call you when I have an opening, or I may refer you to someone else. Usually most students have nothing to add in a conversation and they don't make an impression. They are empty suits. They have no color, no personality, nothing. You ask somebody, what do you know? IFRS, accounting standards, that's it, nothing else. So interestingly, my first major job, my personal experience getting into a bank in Kerala, was the interview. The managing director was an IAS officer, and he said, and I was applying for a job, there were 200 other people applying for the same job, all chartered accountants. And he interviewed me, I got the job out of 200. After I got the job, I came and saw him on the first day at work. I said, why do you hire me? You know, I was very curious, why do you hire me? No? He said, you were the only chartered accountant in the entire 200 lot who could tell me something about recent developments in IFRS, which I had learned by reading Business Week or Business Time, whatever that. I used to read a lot then. It's about some recent change in IFRS, right? Other guys were completely out of touch. Completely. They could tell me something about income tax laws 10 years ago, right? Nothing, but they could not even recollect one item of relevant interest happening in the market. And he remembered that, right? He remembered me out of 200 candidates because he said something memorable. Now, what's your story? How do you make yourself memorable? So there's the list, right? The list is what? Analytical ability. Now, we all come to all this, but then effectively we're talking about what? Soft skills, right? The points in bold are all soft skills. Humility is, again, an aptitude, not really a soft skill. Collaboration is a soft skill. Personal effectiveness is a soft skill, right? And they're critical. If you look at the comments made by various parties, right? Look at the last two. Please look at the last two. 75% of long-term job success depends on soft skills, and only 25% on technical skills. And I can testify to that. My career, same thing. As you go higher up, what becomes more relevant? How you deal with people. It's not about your CA or CFA anymore. In fact, when I was a manager, no one cared about CA anymore, really, or CFA. You know your job, you're good at dealing with people, that's it. And CFA Institute itself, in a recent survey, said what? Overall, soft skills are rated what? As about as important as technical skills. About as important as technical skills. Yeah? Right? Recruiting on campus, again, another Dilbert cartoon here. So let me ask you, why does the gap exist? We have this gap, right? Skills gap. We talked about that, right? So why does all this exist in the Indian scenario? Let's talk about the Indian context, yeah? Because this is
communication.
What else?
Faulty education.
Faulty education. Someone else mentioned that earlier, remember, in our circle. Faulty education. Yes, Lokesh?
Education system.
Anyone in the back? You guys are very quiet in the back, by the way. Yeah? Expectations. So I identify some reasons, by the way. Maybe you can agree with me, right? Yeah. Number one, employers still stress on certifications, isn't it? You go to most interviews, if you're a CA, how many attempts did you take to pass CA? First attempt? Better. Second attempt, please wait outside. Right? They're still obsessed with this whole first attempt, CA, CFA, Kaya thing, right? No one really learned soft skills formally. No one taught me soft skills. No one did. Now there are, of course, courses online, blah, blah, blah. But in those days, it's very difficult to teach soft skills. Actually, soft skills is actually a misnomer. Soft skills are very hard skills to learn, by the way. I don't know why they call them soft skills. It's much easier to learn about FRA or derivatives or economics, but much more difficult to learn how to manage people or delegate or be a good team worker. Trust me, I've been through the whole pain. Yeah. Soft skills are very hard, like I said earlier, right? Emphasis is a lot on technical skills and qualifications. That a lot of you think about. So when I passed, I was telling somebody, when I passed my CA at the age of 23, right? First attempt, it's a very important point again. First attempt. I actually thought I was on top of the world, man. I said, you know what, that's it. There's nothing more to learn, right? The whole body of knowledge that I need to know to live this life has been learned, right? I wrote my name several times a day, Binod Shankar, Chartered Accountant. Binod Shankar, Chartered Accountant. Look at it. Nice. Very nice. That actually, but what do I know? Audit, accounting, taxes, company law, and some stuff which I memorized a lot, to be honest. If you ask me to apply to real work, I would not be able to apply. So that is the impression that most people have, unfortunately, even now. The journey, the story has not changed 30 years later. Unfortunately, it has not changed. I still find students who are in the same phase of mind. That's it, CA bus, CA first attempt pass, and then people put in their LinkedIn profile, CA AIR, All India rank. Okay, very good, fantastic, you're a great All India rank, and they expect people to come to them and give them jobs, you know, bus. Come to their house with their CV, you know, or the job offer typed up and give them. Yeah? And the last two, please, the last two are very, very important, right? The last two extremely important. People don't take ownership of their career. You don't. Indians especially, and because I'm an Indian, from India, lived in India, worked in India, have taught Indians in UAE. A lot of people in UAE are Indians. My students are Indians, really. We prefer to outsource our career to the employer. HR department, right? My boss will take care of me. Somebody will take care of me. Ain't gonna happen. Your career is in your hands, not in the HR manager's hands or your boss's hands, really speaking. Yeah? And finally, a lot of people don't have a growth mindset. Have you heard of growth mindset versus fixed mindset? It's a very important concept. We'll talk about that as well. Yeah? So why the gap? We talked about that, right? Yeah? It's mainly soft skill gap. So how do you close the gap? You tell me. On the left side, you have the gap, right? The skills that you need to acquire. Soft skills, of course, mostly soft skills. All soft skills. On the right side, what should you have? How do you, give me some suggestions, how do you close the gap? Practice. Practice. Anything else? Lokesh, ideas? Mentoring. Okay. Rinda, is Rinda somewhere there? Yes. Training. Any other ideas? Observation. Sandeep? Come on. Shoot something. Learning new skills. So my take. This is what you need, right? And I've sort of matched the two, right? Communication, you can learn communication by reading. Very important on-the-job training. I learned communications are improved by on-the-job training, to be honest. Yeah? Mentoring helps. Mentoring actually appears everywhere, to be honest. Appears everywhere. Collaboration, very important. Personal effectiveness, also very important. On-the-job training is very important. Even if it's an internship, grab it. Even if it's an unpaid internship, take it. You don't know where it'll lead to. Doors might open. You might get some fantastic mentors. Go for it. Yeah. Read a lot, please. I mean, keep up to date. When I teach my CFA class, level one, level two, even level three, I'm shocked at how little they know about what goes around the world. I'm really shocked. Trade wars, Brexit, interest rates, they have no idea. You ask them about page 56 of the CFA curriculum, or LOS 37A in the Schweizer book, they will tell you, even the typo, they'll tell you what typing mistake is made. English, the best way of learning English, in my view, think in English. Stop thinking the mother tongue all the time. Start speaking in English. Watch TVs or movies, read books, read newspapers, write in LinkedIn. Practice, practice, practice. There's no other way. So a lot of my mentees, I actually tell them, every week I want you to post something on LinkedIn in English on a current economic topic. That's what I tell them. There's a deadline. I'll review the post, I'll give you feedback. Forget about the English quality. Just do it. You'll get better with time. Everything gets better with time. Just do it. Start doing that way. This is a takeaway list for you, by the way. It's what you should be doing. Yeah? Reading. I read a lot, like I said, 20, 30, 40 books every year. The best books that I've read are right here in front of you. Okay? If it markets, these three books are very good. Okay? The one in the middle is brilliant. The one in the middle is absolutely brilliant. If you want to learn about the history of economics and markets and crisis, fantastic. No jargons, well researched. Okay? If you want to be concerned about how you can develop yourself, self-development, resilience, behavioral finance, optimism, and a lot of people these days are affected with depression, by the way. Mild depression, moderate depression, serious depression. I've seen it. I've talked about it. Fantastic books on all three topics. Yeah? The last book you probably know, right? Yes. It's a very interesting title, but for me it was a game changer 2 years ago when I was going through a certain phase in life. He's basically saying what? Don't take too many things too seriously. Chill out. Okay? Barking up the wrong tree demolishes lots of the myths that we have in our mind about career and life and learning. A lot of myths are being demolished. And Tribe of Mentors is a fantastic book. Collection of a lot of quotes from about 100, 120, 200 statesmen, investors, billionaires on how to develop your career and invest properly, et cetera, et cetera. Great books. Yeah. So I've classified into three heads, right? Markets, mind, and career and life. Yeah. Find a mentor. Another solution for you to close the gap is to find a mentor. Now, you have to be very careful here about finding a mentor. These are my bullet points about finding a mentor. Find someone you want to be like. Find someone that you have shown your potential to. Don't just walk up to someone and say, mentor me. Ain't going to happen. It won't happen with me. It won't happen with Biharilal Dura. It won't happen with anybody else. Okay? Study the mentor and don't ask for mentorship, but follow, track the mentor, comment, like on what he says, understand what he's saying, his thinking. And then maybe after 6 months, 1 year, whatever, approach him. You'll be surprised. For me, if I want to mentor someone, I must believe in your ability to implement my feedback. If you don't implement what I'm telling you, I'm not going to mentor you. Right? It's a waste of time, right? Ultimately. And be on the same wavelength. For me, it's very important, right? For most mentors, we must connect. We must connect as mentor and mentee. It can't just be, it's not a commercial transaction. It's not buying and selling. It's not even like teaching. It's much more in depth than teaching. And please don't ask popular strangers to mentor you. Okay? As someone on LinkedIn with 2 million followers, or whatever, a million followers, send you a message. Most likely, he won't even read your message or reply to your message. Even if he replies, he won't mentor you for the same reasons. So what should you do? Basically, you keep a mentor. This is what you should do, right? When you have a mentor, once you get a mentor, be very clear. Don't ask him for a job. Have a structure. And you take responsibility. It's not the mentor's job to do things for you. Right? You can't go and cry on his shoulder. He's not a psychiatrist. For that, go and pay fees to a proper medical professional if you have mental issues. A mentor is there to help you in your career, specific purpose, specific role. Okay? And the don'ts, don't be passive. You ask the mentor. The mentor is not going to follow up with you. You have to follow up with him. It's your career, your life, your job. Okay? Don't ask for advice on everything in life, right? Health, can I lift 160 kilos? I'm not an expert. Should I get married? I'm not an expert either. And don't commit to things that you can't deliver. And don't be late, don't be disorganized. These are ground rules based on mentoring. I mentor, I've watched mentors, I've watched mentees. Some things work, some things don't work. Yeah. I have a podcast as well. So this is a new podcast I'm going to launch. Effectively, today is the launch date. Think about its launch date. Another source of way of learning effectively. I listen to a lot of podcasts. This is the one you'll see hitting your email in the next few weeks or months. It's called The Real Finance Mentor. LinkedIn is very effective. A lot of people are connected to me on LinkedIn, but I feel that there's far more that can be said than LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a very limiting medium. It's a very limiting medium. I want to be interviewing people and basically generating ideas and inspiring the younger generation, people like yourself. It's a much better effective medium of doing that, right? It's going to be live very soon. I hope you subscribe. I hope it'll be helpful to you as well. But you can't do any of this. You can't learn any skill, communication skill, collaboration, whatever, without having a growth mindset. So for a long while, I used to have this fixed mind. You know what a fixed mindset is? What does fixed mindset mean? My IQ is limited. My ability is limited. I can't do more than this. I am from a tier 2 city. I can't speak good English. my parents did not, whatever. You can blame who you want to blame, right? I'm either good at it or not. I don't like being challenged. I crumble under criticism very quickly. You can read the whole list, right? I stick to what I know. I know accounting, I'll stick to accounting, that's it. I'm a good bookkeeper. I had to make a shift from there to here, from fixed mindset to growth mindset, personally. So I'm not talking theory here. I was a lot there initially. I used to get humiliated at failure. I used to give up easily. I used to take criticism personally, right? You need to go to the growth, it's a very painful journey. And this painful journey can be facilitated if you have good mentors. Mentorship becomes very important for you because he will sort of coach you because he's been through the same journey, at least I have, right? Makes a big difference. So what are the NPs? What are the takeaways you should take away from this presentation at the end of the day, right? After coming to all this. Number one, you need to be employable, right? That's the whole idea. I mean, no one's doing CA and CFA for the fun of it. A lot of the time, you're doing it to get a job. Number two, you must have an edge. The signature dish that Eric talked about, whatever you have, you must have the edge. What is it? My edge was communication skills from day one. Okay, your edge can be analytical skills, financial modeling, persistence, right? Broad knowledge, whatever it is. Identify the edge, please, and stick to it, and grow it, and develop it. Yeah, qualifications alone are not enough. They're not enough. The day when the CA first attempt would get you through a door are gone. Or a CFA would open doors for you are gone. Soft skills, soft skills, soft skills. It's not about hard skills. You have the hard skills. You know your technical stuff. You don't know, most of you don't know how to deploy soft skills, how to deal with people, how to manage teams, how to be resilient. It's a very long, challenging, and rewarding journey. So I was talking to BD before the session, right? So mountaineering or high altitude cycling is extremely difficult, right? Extremely difficult. So I'm going on an expedition in about 2 weeks' time. It's a serious mountain. It's going to be a lot of living in camps and living on snow with crap food, no internet, no electricity, no running water, right? But I'm doing it because I want to reach the summit. I may make it or not. I may not make it, but I still go back. So it's a very rewarding journey because once you reach the top, it's worth it, trust me. Okay, the view is absolutely worth it, yeah? And take small steps, small, regular, consistent steps. Start today, if possible. Please start today. What I will learn today, yeah? So NPs is what? Never drag your goals down to your current reality. No, upgrade your skills and conviction and meet your potential. All of us have potential. I never thought I would be a platform speaker. I never thought I would pass CFA. I never thought I would be an executive director of an investment bank after my very humble beginnings, like I mentioned at the onset. And very importantly, because your career is in your hands, and your hands only, take charge of your career, because no one else will do it for you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vinod. I think you have already answered most of the questions which people have asked. Vinod mentioned about a lot of his journey about CA. And I can tell him AIR 15.
Oh, wow, okay. I didn't know that. Okay.
So I had a 15th rank in CA final, but I couldn't get a campus placement. And then when I said, okay, look, the third ranker also couldn't get it, so I'm okay. But that's when it started. That's when I realized that look, there's something missing. Maybe, I have the technical skills, but not the, other skills, and maybe I need to learn that. And then I started as a CA firm and then eventually sort of moved this thing. Vinod also talked about luck versus skill. Fortunately, in fund management industry, we have something called a Robert Greene framework, which essentially has only two criteria. One is you need to have managed a billion dollars, so you have managed a sizable portfolio. And you need to consistently beat the benchmark for 10 years, which means two governments and two cycles. And there are three fund managers in India who have done that. Sunil is obviously one of them. So you can look it up. So at least, I don't know how much, but at least it gives you some perspective on that. Vinod, one thing which has come up again and again is, role of a third person to help you out, mentor. And you slightly touched upon it saying that, look, he's not a psychiatrist.
Yeah.
But what's the differentiating line? I mean, I have friends I can talk to. I have fellow colleagues. I have, my juniors, seniors, whatever it is. What's the difference, the mentor, the coach, the friend, the psychiatrist? I mean, where do you draw the line? You obviously put out the do's and don'ts.
Sure. Yeah.
What's the line?
So, good question. So, This is a very important definition, right? A mentor is not a coach, not a psychiatrist, obviously. So what's the difference? A mentor is someone who, like I said, who you look up to, who has done what you want to do, who is a subject matter expert. He's a finance guy, finance director, you look up to him and he's done all those things, he's succeeded in his career. A coach doesn't have to have anything to do with the subject matter. He's a facilitator. So I mentor people because, and I can tell them, listen, boss, if you want to get a job in this role, this is what you should do. You know, acquire the skills, for example, soft skills, hard skills. If I was a coach, I would be an executive coach, where I would be telling the person, not telling them, listening to him saying, you know what are your goals? What do you want to achieve in life? You know, and let me, I can probably tell you what to do. It's up to you to implement it. So coaching and mentoring, very different. Coaching is more facilitating, mentoring is more directing. I'm directing you to do it because I'm the expert and you're listening to me for my advice. Secretary is, of course, a whole different ballgame.
So are you saying one can have a mentor from a non-finance field as well? Or is it only you should look for a mentor in the same field?
Ideally in the same field, because he's been there, he knows the issues, he knows the market. Coaching can be from any field.
Okay.
Doesn't have to be expert at all.
Sure. You said a lot of things about communication, and I think English was mentioned as one of the things.
Absolutely.
Primarily because the financial market is in English.
Yes.
The news, the language, the annual report, the analysis, everything is in English.
Right.
Obviously, India is a diverse country with a lot of vernacular, languages.
Yes.
The Prime Minister is obviously trying to, promote Hindi. So, is it that you can't succeed without this language? Is it like a survival skill? Or is it something which, you have to find your edge at? Maybe, you start research in vernacular language. Where do we draw the line?
Very difficult to say. So I'll give you an example. In China, for example, or in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is a great financial market, right? But you can't get a job as an equity analyst in Hong Kong unless you know?
Mandarin.
Yeah. Because there's a reason why. Because almost all annual reports and communications are in Mandarin, in Chinese, interestingly enough. That's the only market where I know where the local language has such a huge influence.
Yeah.
Every other market has influence in English. Now, to go back to questions, how do you cross that line? Or can we live without knowing English?
Yeah.
It's going to be quite difficult, to be honest. You can probably remain as an original contributor, but it's going to be very difficult to get to leadership. Because to go to leadership, it means communicating your vision, right? And inspiring people and things like that. It's going to be very difficult if you don't have English language skills. As an analyst, as a back office guy, as someone who's not client-facing, you probably don't need that much superb English language skills. But the market is changing, and demands are increasing.
There are a few questions about people trying to move careers, whether as a fresher or whether as a lateral, from offshoring to onshoring, from wealth to mid-office to front office. What you spoke a lot of this obviously resonates with the young audience who is willing to start a career, who obviously have not worked. What about people who have already worked for a few years, maybe, they have developed some of these things? How does one know what he's lacking? Obviously, it's easy to say for a, young professional who's just starting. But how about people who already worked for a few years, and they don't know what they lack? Where does one get that insight into?
Well, I didn't mention something here, which is very important, which is self-awareness. So I think, have you heard of the concept of emotional intelligence, EQ? So one of the key, there are four pillars of emotional intelligence, which is very important. And one of the pillars is self-awareness. And a lot of us are not self-aware, to be honest, about what we lack and what we are good at, even at an advanced age, for whatever reason. So I think self-awareness, and how do you get self-awareness? Feedback. Feedback from who? From colleagues, from your bosses, for example. Going back to earlier question, mentorship helps again. What are you good at? So my boss is telling me what I'm good at and what I'm not good at, in an unbiased way. So if you have a great boss and a great mentor, your career is pretty much going to be much more easier than otherwise. So I think that's the best answer. But to go back to other situation as to if you're mid-career in your 30s or whatever, right, and you want to switch. So I get a lot of requests or queries, not requests, from people saying, I'm in IT and I've finished level 1 and level 2. Can I switch to finance? Right? And my answer is pretty low chance of doing that. Because you're already competing with people younger than you, who are more experienced than you in finance. So it's going to be extremely difficult to switch. My best bet would be, whatever you're doing right now, do it well. Whatever you're doing right now, do it well. And slowly move into finance, maybe in a slowly adjacent way, move into an incremental manner. But you're not going to go from IT manager to equity research analyst in the next 6 months, just because you passed level 2 or level 3. Just as an aside at that point.
Yeah. So last year when we started to hire associates, and obviously we got about 400, 500 resumes for the post of most of them, you know, in CFA candidature status. We only had two conditions. One, that we'll pay you only 15,000 a month as a stipend. And second, you have to act as a part-time accountant. Because we are a small firm, you will have to issue checks, you have to clear vendor payments.
Right?
These are the only two conditions, but you get to work with the team, you get to sort of, you know, meet companies, you get to do research, you get to do work with analysts, you get to directly work with the CIO. That's it. You know, these are the only two things. You need not have any experience. Zero experience. Fortunately, unfortunately, we couldn't get anyone from a candidate pool to come to that role. Eventually, we had to hire a fresh CA who said, look, I will take the plunge and I will go and do. Six months, we tripled the salary, took away the accounting job, and now she is a full-time associate, and now she's pursuing it safely. But there's a lot of expectation mismatch in some terms of, look, I can only do equity research. Is equity research the end of the world? I mean, are there other jobs? What? Where does one look at? I mean, obviously, CFA gears you towards investment management, portfolio management, but how should you sort of broaden the horizon to look at other career options, or, you know, at the beginning of the career? I mean, what's at stake? The leap of faith, which you know Eric talked about, and you know,
it's actually very, very difficult because we live in a country where certain qualifications are by default, right? Yes, I mean, you either become an engineer, or a doctor, or a CA, or a lawyer. If you don't get anything, then you do something you know that no one really bothers about. So I think our education system, our whole the ecosystem is sort of pushing you to do certain things, and then you find that I don't want to do this, for example. So it's very difficult. So my story, right? I grew up in Trivandrum, which is a tier 2 city in Kerala, in South India. I was like a frog in a well. In those days, we didn't have Google or WhatsApp or Facebook, so there was no way of finding out. But I wish now that I knew what I know now, you know, then. I didn't know about the options available to me. I didn't know that I could do an MBA outside, or I could do other things. And that CA was not the only option to me, for example. So I think these days it's much more easier. Like we talked about that before, right, BD? It's much easier these days because you have LinkedIn, you have Facebook, you have Instagram, you have email. I mean, there's so much happening out there. Webinars, TEDx, TED Talks. I mean, anyone coming and saying, I don't know what's happening out there as career options is just being lazy. Because there's so many ways of finding out how to learn and how about new careers. That's my advice to you. A lot of you are connected to me on LinkedIn, for example. I'm sure with other people as well. So why not use it as a great platform to expand your horizon?
So if I am a fresher and I sent you a LinkedIn request for an introduction to someone who's working in finance, or a common connection, think that can you introduce me to someone for an interview or a job, what chances do I have?
Nil. but let me explain why.
So what can improve my chances? Let me rephrase.
Yes.
What if I were to send you a request of introduction to someone?
Yes.
What can improve my chances? What would you like?
See, the biggest issue that I have when someone asks me to introduce me to someone else is that the risk to my reputation.
Yeah.
The risk to my reputation is I introduce, you know, Abhishek or Rinda or somebody to someone, and that someone screws up, right? I don't want that ever to happen. So if you can somehow prove to me, by whatever means, you know, by academics or work performance or whatever, that, you know what, you're a reliable guy, and I will, you know, by recommending you to someone, I'm not going to lose, I'm actually going to gain, then yes. So for example, the people that I recommend the most are my students, obviously, because I know them. Even if they don't ask me, I often recommend them, funnily enough. Because the rapport is there, I know him very well, like a guy who's just studied with me, passed level 1, level 2 like this. He never asked me for a job, but I recommend him for 3 jobs already. Because he never asked me. You know, that's the best part of it. Plus, I know him well. So I think if I can mitigate the risk of of damaging the reputation to myself, if you can assure me somehow, then yes, I'll definitely recommend you.
Yeah. So let me drill down a little bit in terms of, so apart from, I mean, obviously, I know that I don't have communication skills. I know I'm lacking so many things.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
What would prove you my passion, or whatever, you know, we talked about the motivation, or that I can analyze well. So if I write few articles and send it to you as a sample, or write few models, maybe they are wrong, maybe they are completely, this thing.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Will that help in terms of doing some projects, some, you know, samples?
So interestingly, the guy who I have recommended to many jobs, my level 2 pass out student, he willingly takes on extra projects for me, you know? Like I'm a volunteer on CFA Emirates Society. I'm on the board of CFA Emirates in the UAE. And I've asked him to help me on a project. He immediately said yes, and he's a very structured guy, right? Without expecting anything from me, of course, apart from goodwill, he took it on. But to answer your question as to, okay, someone outside the UAE, for example. So I get a lot of people sending me messages saying, you know what, I liked your LinkedIn post, I follow you regularly, I want to learn more about how to get into equity research. Now, that's the kind of conversation I'd like to have, right? Because I can tell him, by the way, do this, do that. Or someone comes to me and says, I want to learn financial modeling. Can you recommend something? How do I learn financial modeling? That shows a, no, I'm not, he's not looking for a job immediately. He wants to learn. And that's fantastic. Yes, that's pretty much my answer.
Sure. How do you turn around things when everything is against you? So if you are, you've been applying for like 6 months for a job, you know, you're applying thousands of jobs, you know, online, nothing coming back, you know, you're attending events, you know, you're meeting people, you're sending CVs, yeah. You know, nothing is working out. Nothing seems to be, seems like, you know, somewhere, you know, something is wrong personally with you and not with the, and economy is obviously not doing well at the same time. And, you know, everybody's questioning, saying, look, you did your level three and there are expectations around you. What do you do?
Give up. Just kidding. No. I'm just kidding, by the way. Just kidding. So interestingly, I get lots of messages through LinkedIn. And this candidate, after the June exam, she messaged me saying, I've been looking for a job. And I wrote level two now. And I'm not got any job. I'm desperate, right? And the actually email sent to me. And she was based in Mumbai. And the email was so long, I got worried, right? I said, she was depressed. I said, let me talk to you. Give me a phone number. I need to talk to you, right? I called her up in Mumbai. And I found that she'd been looking for a job for 3 weeks. I said, OK, so 3 weeks. A few interviews didn't happen. But she's got some other leads. I said, listen, let me tell you facts of life, right? I qualified my CA in July. My first job was in December. After appearing for so many interviews, sending so many applications to God knows where, the first, and the job was not a great job, let's face it, okay, without going into details. So I said, I waited for 5 months, and you're already giving up after 3 weeks. So I think people have to have very realistic expectations. I think, for lack of a better word, people are becoming very intolerant and very impatient. They expect things to happen. Am I right, or am I, that, I think that's one thing. I think, hold, the second thing, BD, is she found out that she lacked a key skill. So for example, she was not good at interviews, basically. And she was not good at company research. So basically, she would not research companies before going to interviews, which is a no-no, right? Before you go to interview, you must know about the employer.
Employer.
So I had a quick chat with her for 15, 20 minutes. And now, by the way, she's working for a Citibank in Mumbai, not because of me or anything, but I'm just saying. So things get sorted out. Yeah. So don't give up. It takes time. The market is not good, as we know this, but it's a cycle. Things get better with time. Just be patient. And interestingly, if you're not getting a job, do that. Use that time to learn something new, to be honest. Learn financial modeling or data science or read some great books. I mean, there are a lot of ways of employing your time.
So quickly, so top three things you would want candidates to do immediately after level three pass exam or any exam, you know, top three skills you would want them to learn.
One, I think career management skills.
Okay.
I think they know how to study and pass exams. They have no idea or little idea of how to progress in a career. Okay. The CFA Institute actually got resources on their career site on the CFA Institute website. How do you prepare yourself for a career? It's about everything from CV writing to LinkedIn to interviewing skills, everything else. Yeah, and that's critical. I think that's one, career management skills. Secondly, soft skills. We talked about that. Personal effectiveness, communication, collaboration. You need to develop that. And thirdly, some domain skills. Anything domains, financial modeling, for example, or something that can be applicable in a particular set, use that as well.
Yeah. So you mentioned something about networking.
Yes.
So, I mean, and you've been on the CFA Emirates, and we have seen some of the work which you do. How does networking, or where does CFA Society can help you, you know, get there where you want to get?
So, interesting networking, actually, it actually happened where I was in Dubai attending a CFA networking event, and I'd taken along a student of mine, right? And I wanted to introduce her. I introduced her to one of my very senior colleagues as a, you know, fund manager. The first thing she asked him was, can you give me a job? So... So that is not the networking I meant. That's not the networking I meant. So I think networking, I think, has to be quite carefully done in terms of how you approach people. Yeah, and that's pretty much the skill has to be learned over time, to be honest. You can't just ask people for a job.
So let me rephrase. Yeah. How can you leverage your existing CFA Society resources or the membership
that way. Okay.
To get into what
so,
you want?
So quick question. How many of you in this room actually have attended past CFA India Society events? Apart from Abhishek and Sandeep and BD, can you please raise your hands? Apart from the office bearers of CFA India Society, obviously you would have attended the meetings, right? How many of the, can you keep raising your hands, please? 15, 20, 25, in a room of 260 people, okay? I'm not saying this because I was invited to speak by CFA Society India or because, you know, BD is sitting here. I think CFA Society is doing a lot for candidates compared to other societies in, say, UAE or other parts of India or Asia. I strongly, strongly encourage you to come and attend networking events. Today is one event. 28th of September, we have in Mumbai. Next March, again, we have in Bangalore. I really want you to come and attend events, meet people. People hire people. People do not hire CVs. I'll say it again. Okay? I won't hire your CV. I'm hiring you. So please turn up at networking events. Okay? Don't ask for a job immediately, like my ex-student. and connect with people, know them, establish an impression in their minds, and someday later they might remember you and give you a call.
So just and on the same note, I had a second-year BCom student come to me last November, trying to understand a bit about AIF and what we do and stuff. Basic stuff, he said, and you know, no expectation. He came, he was persistent, I ignored his email, but he came. I met him, I explained him what we do, this is how the AIFs are. Matter done, he went ahead. He kept on sending me a few articles which he liked about AIF and you know, some of the news articles. Come June, we had an internship opportunity and he was looking for an internship and he just asking that, look, I'm looking for an internship, can you help me know which company I should look for? He said, why do you look for? I mean, we are hiring for an intern, why don't you just come? And he came in and, you know, he interned with us and obviously, you know, that's how it worked. So 6 months ago, I didn't know that we will hire an intern and 6 months later, he was interning with us. And he is just like a second year BCom. Internship is not even required for a graduation, you know, course, but he's doing it. Last question, very quickly. You spoke about this, podcast on mentoring. Obviously, mentoring is something which keep on talking about. We need a mentor.
Yes.
What's
behind the whole thing? Interesting. So I thought LinkedIn was a very limiting medium. And I thought from the messages I get from LinkedIn and phone calls I get and emails, there's a lot of people out there who need guidance. A lot of bright, ambitious youngsters. And I met quite a few of you today as well, right? So the objective here is basically insights and inspiration. I think you need both, right? You need to be inspired, but also you need career insights. So this is probably, and I'm probably saying it because from my own point of view, probably the only podcast in the world focusing on careers and finance. I'm not going to stray outside of that. I'm going to stick to my core competence. CFA, investments, markets, based on my experience. A lot of interviews with candidates, with senior professionals, so probably I'll invite you as well, one day, if you don't mind appearing on that. You'll probably
no
hear
jobs,
me.
Please.
Probably,
no jobs.
No jobs, please, no jobs, yeah. And because I relate well to the student community, I'm the career chair back at Dubai as well, and I'm very empathetic towards their issues. And because it's career focused, I think it'll make a great difference in the podcast scene. There are probably about 600,000 podcasts out there, right? I mean, and increasing by the hour. But I hope this will stand out because I wanted to make an impact. The same impact I hope I've made today, but multiplied 100-fold to a lot of the other people.
So I think each one of us has a mountain to trek and a mountain to cover and a peak to see. Yes. Which one you are going next, that's the question everybody wants to know.
Confidential.
Until we find out from his pictures. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys. Wonderful discussion.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.